it really is an absolute special honor for us to be in the company of such a musical wizard and legend. Please join me in welcoming the amazing Mr. Van Dyke Parks.
Well, I'm not the only wizard here. I know that we're in a sea of wizardry. Yeah. I know that, and I appreciate it.
So you selected that piece of music to kick things off today. Well, what was it?
Yeah, that is from, there were 800 copies of a record just released for Record Store Day. And that is in that record. It begins an album called The Super Chief, which is to document my trip, an instrumental fantasy, as it were, to document my trip, my first trip to California in 1955 on the Super Chief, the great luxury train line. It took me 3 days to get from Princeton Junction to Pasadena, California. And that was the first piece from that fantastic, grandly irrelevant piece of music I wrote called The Super Chief.
And there's definitely a cinematic theme in a lot of your arranging. One of your first breaks was actually working in the movie business, am I right?
Well, I don't know if you call that a break. It might have been better to study engineering or dentistry, but I chose music early, and I went to a boarding school in Princeton, New Jersey, outside of Princeton. At that time, it was called the Columbus Boy Choir School, and I was immersed in music from a very early age. I was the youngest of four boys. We all played instruments. My first real instrument was clarinet. We all played. I had a brother who played trumpet. Another played French horn. The oldest played double barrel euphonium. So we made a racket at every Noel. We would go around and we'd play our way through neighborhoods. And in sometimes freezing weather, I was the only one with a wooden mouthpiece. So I felt rather superior and fortunate if you ever had brass on your lips in a snowstorm. You know what I'm talking about. So music was it. To support that tuition, my father was a doctor. Much of his work was for nothing but for the love of mankind, which I don't think is a misspent aim. We had to raise the tuition, and I came into New York City repeatedly in the 50s to support my education in music, and it's all about music for me. It's the highest math. It's what brings us together today. It leads to the song form, the most portable piece of cultural baggage we can carry. We don't even have to pick it up. As long as it has melody, of course, something like, a through line, it needn't have melody. But sometimes it does, and when it does, it can escape with you as you exit a room with a fantastic and powerful memory. So I think music is very butch. I love it. It brings musculature to my every social aim. And sometimes it's a velvet glove with a strong fist enclosed. Sometimes it's a consolation prize. But music has such potential to realize everything we want of the human spirit. Let's not be bothering Jesus with all this horse shit, but you get what I'm saying here. I believe so heartily in music. So those that are here that might suspect that it's other than a glorious ride, I guarantee you it's worth it as I enter my eighth decade. I swear to that.
And one piece of music that definitely, I think it's fair to say, brings us all together in the room, because I would find it hard to believe that there's someone here that hasn't been touched by this moment in their life, is one of the very first things that you worked on.
Look for the bare necessities, the simple bare necessities. Forget about your worries and your strife. I mean the bare necessities, all Mother Nature's recipes that bring the bare necessities of life.
Okay, that's it. All right. That was 1963. 1963, I got my first union job. That was the year we had a Cold War. We had been recovering from Nikita Khrushchev banging his shoe on the dais of the United Nations. We were in a Cold War. Unfortunately, my brother was in Frankfurt, the vice consul of Frankfurt, and he died that year. And to get to his funeral, I got a job, and they gave me money to arrange that piece. I got a black suit and a two-way ticket to the grave. And if that isn't a burning bush, if that isn't God in action, I don't know what the hell is. And that was my first job. Basically a glorified rhythm track, but it gave me the idea that there was money in music. And that's something I just found phenomenal. And so 1963, that was the year Bob Dylan came out with his first album, The Freewheelin' Bob Dylan. That was the year the Rolling Stones co-opted the American Delta Blues in 12 by 5. That was a sea change in music. That's when every man could sing, Sprechstimme. The thing that I'd learned as a child in the boy choir by people like Schoenberg was now on the street. Anybody could sing. If he could play a guitar, he could get somewhere. And so I went from the coffee houses that I'd played since 62. I went to up and down the coast of California. I went into the studio and started exploring the opportunities in a studio. And that really became my laughing place, the place that I loved to be. That's where I wanted to remain. Because I'd drawn a distinction between performance music and recorded music. I did that in 1948. I was 5 years old and I heard a Spike Jones tune called Cocktails for Two, filled with ear candy, tuneful percussion. Things that I'd heard like only through Sousa on parades as people marched down the street and earshot on American holidays. Now it was in the studio and tuneful percussion became a very important obsession for me in recording. It still is. You notice with the Bare Necessities, you're hearing a room sound. You walk into a room and that probably was the first take. People look at music and they start playing together and the room sounds. Well, technology of music, and I'm starting to talk about it, animated itself into a real sea change right about that time, about 1963, 64. We went from 3-track to 4-track tape. It was a big deal. And I knew there was a difference between recorded and live music. From going from a piece where the room sounded to a piece that in which you could impose different perspectives on acoustic instruments. A mandolin might be triumphal in the foreground, in the face, with a wall of brass blowing their brains out in the background because of miking. So, tell you the truth, I was at the right place at the right time to participate in all that wondrous journey that studio technology brought. And this hour, I figure, with your indulgence, I will stammer my way through a discovery of where that led me, all kinds of interesting places that prove, once again, that production that is as a credit is a failure in engagement, in contrast to arrangement and really participating, where you can define the proscenium of a piece. You can exalt what is humble. You can articulate what seems to the casual observer like a fuzzy, far-off event as small as a YouTube download. So that's the end of the sentence.
I think that sentence deserves a round of applause. So one thing that, I mean, obviously we're a room full of musically minded people,
yeah,
from all differing backgrounds of production and taste. But one thing that I would really love you to expand on in today's talk is what you just mentioned, which is the art of arranging. And maybe, you know, while we navigate through that, you could think of a few musical examples we could use to show really your experience in arranging, and maybe talk us through the process of what being an arranger is.
Well, music, you know, seems to me like a tremendous remedy, almost like the last thing on anybody's mind. In film work, it's the last thing done. In a vertical hierarchy, all the money is spent on blowing dust around, making people up, spending money on contracts, getting an extra trailer for a diva who just didn't want to be so close to her male co-star, maybe falling out of love during an embrace in a picture. All of those problems can only be reconciled with music. So music is the great remedy to me. And it is also in arranging for basic tracks. Real interesting to me that two things are involved in the recording process, usually. Although events now are stampeding ahead of me, and I'm in a state of perpetual wonder about whether Spotify is spotless, what's happening to fractional profits in music and so forth, and how to position myself as a mere survivor in this new era of music. I understand it far less than anybody here. But in my experience, two things happen that are very interesting in the equation of arranging. An extemporaneous process might meet head-on with a premeditated event. So you might come up with a bass, drums, and guitar, and a vocal that needs somehow to be, enunciated, clarified, confirmed in their certain truths and excellence, and somehow maybe like cosmetically cured with distractions that only a good arrangement can offer. It's not true that an arrangement should always just be felt and not heard. Sometimes an arrangement should definitely be heard. And I've made great mistakes in miscalculating. Just as a personal aside, something I think is very important to say, you must reserve the right to fail. If you're going to get anything done, you must continue aggressively to reserve the right to fail. You must keep learning from your failures. I see how shy I was when I could afford to be shy, because I was a brunette and I had time to be shy. But soon you'll tire of being shy, if you are shy at all. If you're that victimized by the degree of self-loathing coming from your last failure. But you must continue to forgive yourself and reserve the right to fail. So what happens is the extemporaneous process then meets what's premeditated. Arranging to me isn't something like the design of a camel with a committee. Basically, everybody's got to get lost while you think about what it takes to arrange. You're holding the bag. It's your job. You cannot, with the power of dialogue, do anything to ameliorate the crisis that is imposed on the arranger. You must face that alone. It's a monastic process. And that is what I love about it. That it's collaborative, but it's also terrifically solitary and confining, hermetically sealed from two, in the case of my work a couple of days ago before I took the red eye to Red Bull. My first red eye, by the way, is interesting. Life is so full, always something new. So But I did an arrangement in 2 days, but it felt like it could have been a year. I was so frozen, immobilized in front of a computer. I no longer write because of an injury from overwriting. Everything now is through sequencing, by the way. I use Digital Performer in my work as an arranger. It's a Luddite's last refuge. I do it because it's what I learned, and there are many, many things come into play in arranging that improve the facility, the speed of the event. But there's always an important ingredient in that. With that speed comes the need for hesitation between inspiration and execution. So often I find myself doing even up to 24 bars, and I'll finish that, drink some wine after I've finished the meal and cleaned up between every preparation. My wife thinks that cook is a noun. So between all of those events, I might get up the next morning and just wipe out that 24 bars and move on. So an arrangement, I allow myself an arrangement of a song, and if you all are interested in a song form and surviving as an arranger, and I recommend it, I allow myself 5 days for an arrangement, no matter whether it's a banjo and a jew's harp or an entire orchestra with a lot of vertical responsibilities. Everybody has to have something to play. But I do that. I take those moments between inspiration and execution very seriously. You must have time to give pause while doing an arrangement. But both of those things fascinated me. You see, the business of extemporaneous work. If you go on YouTube and you look at my name, it's Van Dyke is my first name, and go Rye Cooter. And if you punch in the word Hollywood, Rye Cooter, Van Dyke, Hollywood, you'll see a filmic event that is absolutely, it's going to knock your socks off. It shows you how I get occasionally in life to participate extemporaneously and how much I love it, how much joy it brings me. But that isn't the luxury I usually have. Usually, it's sitting at home, frozen in front of a computer, and doing an arrangement. I'll tell you something. I think it would really be good to... What's the next thing that's up there? Okay, so I go on from one thing or another, but I finally get an opportunity to do what I do best, and that is I like to articulate everything in strings. I use a lot of strings. I know it's very retro, but I love strings. To me, that's a heavenly engagement. I don't play a fretless instrument. I spent one semester in school on a cello, and it was a painful experience for anyone who came close. But it wasn't until my son played violin that I actually got a string instrument in the house. But this shows what I do most commonly. This is an early attempt at an arrangement. One Meatball on Rye Cooter's first album, which I co-produced. It's called One Meatball, the record Rye Cooter.
Meatball was all he had.
arch liberal, kind of left-wing liberal, tree-hugging, commie-sympathizing lyrics there from the Depression, all about the difference between being rich and being poor, and I've been both in New York City, I guarantee you that. So I understood the piece, and sometimes you notice that the violins at the top would support the melody of a person so circumspect and so in doubt about his vocal ability that I felt it was appropriate to strengthen the melody. Sometimes I do that with the first violins. Now, it's interesting. Are any of you interested in string arrangements? Okay, here's the bit. This is what I do. This is what I found. What I didn't make this up. Nobody taught me this, but this is what I do. I always record with three violin lines. I divide them. Three violins, two violas, one cello, and one bass. That's what I do all the time. And the reason for that is because, you see, with these five voices up there, the three violins and the two violas, I can have triadic events. I can have a line or an octave duplicated line at the top holding the thing together, while these three interior voices, that would be the third violins and the two violas, all have a triadic opportunity. So what are you doing? With strings, all of a sudden, these strings are getting bold and beautiful. There's a physicality there. You don't have to have a drummer going pa-ta-ta-ta-pa, pa-ta-ta-pa-pa. You don't have to keep returning to the ubiquity of the trap set to get some rhythm. Maybe even if you put some rhythm in your strings, a drummer can find a way to lay back and still be involved with great economy. So that's what I found out. Three violins, two violas, one cello, one bass. Well, unfortunately, a violin is an instrument of infinite approximate pitch. And if you put two violins together, you're not really doing them a favor because you're inviting intonational problems. So you must have three. That unifies the field and it starts to sound like a note. Sometimes that note is slightly out of tune, what the Brazilians call desafinado, agreeably out of tune. But that to me is the irreducible minimum for an orchestrating with an arranger who wants to bring the heat of the street into the parlor to meet the elite. It's nine violins and six violas, one cello will do, and one bass. My love for strings, it was so born of my own intimidation about the fact that I'm not a real musician, that everything I get musically just comes from blood, sweat, and tears. I sweat bullets to come up with everything. It's all due diligence with me. I want to prove to you what this secret knowledge, going to a boy choir school, learning music, listening to a lot of dead white guys, doing the drill, crying a lot, not getting laid, being lonely, being a musician, it was tough to get the experience to even enter the field of arranging. I want to show you where all of this knowledge paid off and the academic results became clear. Please play Good Vibrations. One cello got me.
I love the colorful clothes you wear and the way the sunlight plays upon her hair. I hear the sound of a gentle wind on the wind that lifts her perfume through the air. I'm picking up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations. I'm backing up good vibrations. She's giving me the excitations.
Close my eyes. She's somehow closer now. Softly smile, I know she must be kind.
I went into a Beach Boys session, and without any employment opportunity, went in there, and thank God it occurred to me to suggest that a cello play tripletize fundamentals on the chorus with a bow. And Brian Wilson reached to the control in the control room with great control. He had such great control, and the gift of mutual empowerment, which is a requisite for any good musician. And he got on that control button, and he said to that cellist, who was somewhat puzzled that he was looking at an empty music stand, and he said, "Jesse," it was Jesse Ehrlich was the man's name, generation beyond us, "Jesse Barco." Jesse looked up from the music stand, "Barco?" I said, "No, Brian, Arco, with a bow. Arco, with a bow." And this is what happened, and it became like the ruby slippers that clicked in The Wizard of Oz, the signature shot for that piece. And that got me 8 months of infamous employment as a lyricist. So you never know where music's going to take you either. But that is, you see, the power, the rhythmic potential of a string section. In that case, it was just one player. But it speaks worlds about the physical possibility in string rhythms. And I really love that. I love that world. And I find myself, it's second nature to me. I feel like a boy and a dolphin. When I go into that world, it's just, it gives me all kinds of flotation. I just love it and recommend it as the beginning for all your ideas. Now, how do I get there? You might be interested. Let me give you a trade secret, the one I use. I was once a pianist, an able pianist. I do everything in front of a keyboard now. I would be lost. I know a great arranger, Lenny Niels. He does half times at Super Bowls and endless numbers of play-ons and playoffs at Academy Awards shows. And so this great tenor sax man and has insinuated himself into jazz literature, arranged for Stan Kenton on a bus with nothing else in front of him. Lenny would do an entire orchestration. I watched him in process, and he would turn the page to the next four bars with full orchestra and not have to look where he had left a flute, a second flute, or a bassoon. He just kept going, maddeningly talented. I don't have the problem of talent. I take a long time, but I find that It just disgusts me how people privatize knowledge. I decided not to do that. I tried to give away what it is that I paid dearly to learn. And here's such a lesson. If you're a pianist, you know, some of my favorite music of the American scene, and I had one lesson conducted by Aaron Copland, for example. I mean, I've had some great opportunities. Somebody asked him, "What is American music?" He said, "Well, it's anything that was written in America," which I think is a wonderful way to just wrap it up. It's, you know, it came from America. That's what American music is. So I think that there's a desperate attempt to brand all kinds of maverick music, whether it's in America, of America, or just Mac World, which is the American hegemony in its most giant, inappropriate form. The way to get there from here in an arrangement, if you're using strings, and then I'll wrap this up. I know it's sounding, I'm starting to sound like a dweeb, aren't I? I don't want to sound like a dweeb. I want to be very hip. But the way to get there is, if you're a pianist, my favorite American music is, let's say Gershwin. And my favorite Gershwin is, let's just say, two piano Gershwin. And what you get in two piano Gershwin, it's available anywhere. I would listen to that if I were you, to see what happens in two piano assaults. Very interesting, because you get a very detailed and specific articulated left hand left hands, and you also get all the decorative qualities that are available in tenor events and so forth. This is the way I construct strings. I get basically two treble bass braced pieces of information, and I study it. And it's from that that I didact the strings. So like everything below a low C is wiped out as I study the viola possibilities. Then everything below a low G is wiped out as I study the violin possibilities. So it's then with deductive reasoning that you find yourself able to quickly, I mean, when time is the money of love and deadlines are deadly, this is an easy way to get where you're going. And I recommend it, that you try that technique to get quickly through a string arrangement.
You touched on sort of classic American sounding music, and of course it is very easy to just say, well, that's any music from America, but you have been on record as sort of having a direct reaction against what you called the Anglicization of music in the 60s during the sort of Beatles mania that was going on. And if you could pick a style of music that was classically American, I mean, you could do a lot worse than picking out the Beach Boys as a classic sort of, you know, American sound. Seeing as you raised this classic Smile session, which is probably one of the most folkloric recording sessions ever, a lot of people said that, you know, had this album come out at the time, that it would have been the American Sgt. Pepper's or the equivalent. Could you paint us a picture of what it was like going into that environment, how you met Brian Wilson and the Beach Boys, and really what those recording sessions were like?
Well, as you know, like I said, I mean, to wrap it up, what I learned in that was not so much a musical as it was social. The lessons, the social lessons, turned out to be absolutely indelible. To see somebody at this, in this case, you see, I think the fascination is at those who give a damn about it, about anything pre-Elvis the Younger. Looking back on this, the most indelible impression I have is what came out of it as a social lesson in how to make music. One guy was in charge, and that guy was the most incredible. I mean, in terms of tonnage, he was the most powerful man in music production as a songwriter, publisher, group leader, arranger, and so forth. He sold more records than anybody. He was the top dog in the American pop music scene. And I define pop as something that happened after popular music died. And in that year, 1963, that year that Andy Warhol came out with his Campbell's soup can, all the arts went pop. It was a big deal in music, of course. So being in the Beach Boys session was very much like that. All the extemporaneous processes were at play. The good thing about it is there was a standard, the usual suspects always showed up. So they were people that had played together with a sense of what you call repertory theater, musicals, musically speaking. Everyone had played together. They had a very a tacit relationship that was still very dynamic. Everyone respected everyone, and they also expected the unexpectable. And that's what I remember about it. Much unexpected event took place. I found myself once on my hands and knees playing the organ pedals. It was just that too much velocity was required. I had to, but you'll hear one of those organ notes in Good Vibrations. It's almost subsonic. It's just too hard to find. We don't need to go search it.
Vibrations, take one.
But
we're rolling. Let's go.
You notice there's an economy in the ideas. You see that this is chamber music in a way. So I found that chamber sensibility very refreshing. And what it took was to be the ability for the musicians to go along gladly. There was no time to feel superior. Nobody had time to feel superior. And I've learned something from that. I escaped serious music by getting into unserious music. Now, you see, you don't have a problem with that. I don't believe you have a problem with that. I think you will find that you can be taken seriously, even if you're doing music that you might think is just being thrown out there with the feel-good potential. I think this is very interesting, but when I was coming up, there was a definite demarcation between serious and unserious music. I wasn't going to be serious about Edgar Varese anymore. I found possibilities of music concrete right in that, if you listen to Good Vibrations, just before that glottal ah that hit where the tape is cut. I found music concrete in popular music to be much more interesting. I found non-serious music to have this political potential, that it would make a difference to be involved with music to which people were dancing or communicating thoughtlessly. And to me, that became the hardball game, the one I wanted to be swinging in. And in short, it was a great opportunity. I was right at the right time at the right place.
And you wrote most of the lyrics on that album, right?
Well, I wrote most of the lyrics. I found myself to be a lyricist, but still able to make a musical contribution. And I don't eat light bulbs. And I think and I do believe that old caution that by no title, merit, nor honor is any true man elated. And I think that extends to women too. I think titles are absolutely an absolute folly when it comes to trying to figure out what comes from a collective endeavor. And what I love about that music, and darn it, just about everything that I've done in music I can think of right now, it's all ultimately a collaborative confirmation. Isn't that interesting?
Let's go further on that, and the difference between taking someone's idea or someone's creation and then doing your interpretation, i.e. arrangement on top of that, and the difference between being an artist yourself and the creative pressure that comes from having to do it all from scratch. Because after the Smile sessions were sort of abandoned, you recorded Song Cycle, is that correct?
Yeah, well, I went on to a record called Song Cycle, and they sat on it for a year, and it was ignominiously put on the shelf. And then it appeared somehow, almost in a piratical move, on a jukebox in Greenwich Village. I went out and got an electromechanical reproduction of a coin going into a machine. It reminded me of the time that I first put a nickel in a jukebox to hear. That was called Memories Are Made of This. It was the first time I ever put a nickel in a jukebox. And so I wanted the coin to go in, and then at the end, of course, because I learned that it's possible to turn tape around, the coin comes out at the end. This I eviscerated, that is, I made waste of a beautiful diatonic, a do-re-mi thing that was written by a very unpopular Donovan was his name. They thought he was a Bob Dylan wannabe, and I felt kind of sorry for him, but I was absolutely impressed by his piece called Donovan's Colors, and I had at it, and this is what came out of my madness.
Thank you.
Okay. So, yeah. But, you know, it's like Ted Turner said, it only looks easy. I had to start with an ostinato. I didn't know where it was going. I didn't know when I would return to it. But I started with a repeated figure on that simple tune called Donovan's Colors. The marimba, I thought, was a very able. But nobody had told me that by having the tape speed, I might reach an octave. And I learned that. Seat of the pants. And so I played the marimba part at half speed and then brought it up to speed. I wasn't afraid to show my madness in that piece. I wanted to follow it wherever it would take me. But I had been in the mothers of invention, and I'd seen crazier people working out. So I had,
which is Frank Zappa's band.
Frank Zappa's group. So I had no fear of being considered insane. And Warner Brothers got the results of that single record. I did it under a pseudonym because I wanted to protect my family from the infamy of my musical criminology. I wanted to protect them, and I put that record out as George Washington Brown, a fictitious pianist from South America. And that they wouldn't permit me to sign on at Warner Brothers with an album, so I used my own name after that.
I mean, the majority of that music at that time that you're involved with does feel very experimental for the time and pretty trippy almost. I mean, was it quite a psychedelic time at that period?
Well, I had some psilocybin, but I never participated in this LSD stuff you're talking about, and I don't understand it when people who I don't understand it when people talk about psychedelia. They don't know what they're talking about, but it's a good buzzword. Look at Ice Capades, that you'll see right down there.
Yeah.
This took me to the Moog synthesizer. I was one of four boys in town that had one, and I did these commercials. And this is when there was no keyboard. There was just a phalanx of wires, and you put them together. You started out with pink noise. That is every sound in the visible or the audible spectrum, and you came up with a note. And maybe that note would be, well, if it were an ambulance, it would be a sawtooth wave with a sine control voltage. You'll hear what came out musically where this desire to experiment in the studio took me in this Moog music. It was tough. That was for a commercial for Ice Capades. I actually did teach the synthesizer how to say Ice Capades. And you go and you go into a parking lot now. It says, "Please take the ticket," and you take artificial voices as for granted. But in those days, I was just thinking about the medical potential. This is before I even heard the word Stephen Hawkins. I thought that this might really have some serious applications. And I had too much to do to be psychedelic. I had to keep a roof over my head, and I had to be an arranger, and I arranged for a lot of people. Why don't you play the one I did for Bonnie Raitt? This reveals my love for Calypso. Women in power.
Every night. And if the woman says she's feeling sexy,
what she gonna do?
And the man says he's feeling sleepy,
what she gonna do?
And she bawling, come on, doo-doo. And this time it's up like soft Shenandoah satisfaction. So you see, a woman must have an outside man.
So that was your work with Bonnie Raitt. And just going back to the album we played before, Song Cycle, which is referenced by so many artists through the decades as like a really critically acclaimed body of work, it's fair to say that it's not, you know, as commercially well known as some of the other artists that you've worked with. I thought it'd be interesting to talk a little bit about the difference between being the artist and also being comfortable, as it seems, playing more of a background role in music.
Well, background's a bad word to use.
Let me give you a
sidelines,
quote.
I think it's a good sidelines is a good word to use.
All right.
Okay. When you're an artist, you can do anything. You only must be true to yourself, and that truth shall make you whole. If you're just true to yourself, but when you're working for somebody else, Jesus doesn't give a damn about that. You have an obligation to somebody else and to serve them and their expectations, however heightened they may be. So it's the absence of personality all of a sudden comes into play. You find that in film scoring especially. Being nobody is often very important than trying to be somebody. Being interested is essential. Being interesting is Dullsville. I learned that. I learned it the hard way. I became a record artist. All of a sudden, I found myself punished critically by being myself, being true to myself. But ultimately, what I learned by being an artist brought me into such understanding, I mean, that I became indispensable once present to a lot of people in making their cases clear. And that's something. So that's the difference to me. One is by being somebody, the other is by being nobody.
I don't like pulling up things that people have said before, but one quote that I had to write down was that you said is that when someone blew John Kennedy's brains out in the face of fame, I realized there might be some value in anonymity.
That's right. I think anonymity is a blessing, and it gives you a chance to stop worrying. I mean, I've seen a lot of famous people. I don't know, there might be a lot of you who think that fame is indispensable to the very idea of surviving in music. I don't think it's important. I've seen so many peers, people my age, who've spent a lifetime getting famous, and I see them walk into a crowded room with two terrible things on their mind. One, what if everybody notices me? And the other, what if nobody notices me? So it's a problem, this thing about fame. It looks to me like it's the hangnail on every social situation. You just, why? Do it. I don't understand it. And anonymity has been a blessing to me as I pursued this arranging career that I've had principally. This, I think, all shows that there, everything has served to further my desire to be part of the team, to be a good beta male. This is what I like about arranging. It's reactive more than creative, but I can't really tell the difference between those things. But I would say by being willing to be reactive, you get so much more done than if you're in peril because someone expects something creative out of you. And that applies to self-analysis too. By the way, just to let you know, I have pursued cliche so much to try to even make it an art form. That's part of, I think, what is my signature, to try to just almost get to the unsueable offense, in quotation. I wanted to be a pirate, but you can't really make a living being a pirate. You must do something special with these stolen goods, these references you bring. If you're going to become an artist in cliche, you saw what I did to Bonnie Raitt on that song, basically, that is a testament to women's empowerment. Looking at that field of calypso, which has been such a big part of my life, having to follow a calypso of a steel band in a coffee house in Southern California, I learned so much about good rhythms, real rhythms, not imagined rhythms, rhythms that came from Africa. Look at this. I finally got to, I got where I wanted to be as a producer for the Mighty Sparrow. One day in a hurricane. Let's go to Moorcock. By the way, one day, this entire album was done in one day. Sparrow went up, the Mighty Sparrow, went up to a piano and he did this. Now, and the orchestra exploded into performance. I asked him about derivatives of that rhythm, the merengue, bygone, and so forth, and he told me that the in Trinidad, there's this, it's like asking people what jazz means. Where did this come from, this crooked beat that pushed the measure forward? And he said that in Curacao, was the fable was that Curacao, a lot of people hold to it, that Peter Stuyvesant, who became, after he was Governor General of Curacao, came from the Caribbean and came to be the Governor General of New Amsterdam. He had a peg leg. One of his knees was on a wooden stick, and the natives decided to popularize the Governor General's gait in music. Here is Moorcock, One Day in a Hurricane in Miami.
Friendship end. The woman Judith, who he lived with, complaining to me. So much cock in the house and she buys Odi. Wrong or right?
Cock up.
Middle of the night.
Cock up.
Sun or rain.
Cock up.
Sickness or pain.
Cock up.
Tell the man when you see him for me, this kind of thing ain't go up. And if he don't want to stop, I will kill the cop.
No literature, no literature at all. Same day.
Maria, darling, I must go. But remember, I love you so. Unfortunately, we must part. Girl, you don't know how it breaks my heart. I wish I could stay with you and give you what is yours to do. But until we meet again, I know right now we got to say I owe. Oh, 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 oh,
oh, Maria.
Oh. Mighty fine arranging by Earl, by the way, Earl. Earl Grant. But so there's a room that sounded right away. I mean, the guy just went boom, 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 bang. All during Hurricane Edna, one day in 1971 in Miami. We were on independent generated power. We got through a record in a day. And that's from a record called Hot and Sweet by the Mighty Sparrow, reminding me about Earl Rodney was the arranger of that piece. About the power of arrangement in presenting a song. Now I just came up with it. Just Let's do something before we do this. Let's go to Spanish Moon. Here, this is in the same year, 1971, with Little Feet, Spanish Moon.
Hey, Betty, what are you
arranging brass kind of similar to the way that you approach strings, or I mean, is that a completely different beast?
Well, no. Well, no, that's different. This is to a rhythm track. This arrangement is to a rhythm track. I use the Tower of Power, by the way. It's different. But this is the genius of Lowell George, the late lamented, my very good friend Lowell. But all a part of that great American quilt work we call Americana. I learned so much from Lowell. I learned how to sit on a chord on this piece. One of the greatest pieces I've ever heard is Yes We Can by Alan Toussaint, one of my very close friends of producers, Southern Night Records, if you know that one. Yes, We Can. One chord. Just to range freely, just to take just a few minutes, then we'll be through with this show and tell. Why don't we, here's another arrangement. Here's a simple, a view of Americana. Let's go to The Parting Hand. The Parting Hand. This is from my new record called Songs Cycle, 1886.
Sweetest union, join your friendships like a drawing band, yet we must take the parting hand. Your company sweet, your union dear, your words delightful to my ear. You draw like chords around my heart. How sweet the hours have passed away since we have met to sing and pray. How low we are to leave the place where Jesus shows his smiling face. That we must take the parting hand.
Thank you.
That's a song from 1886, the Sacred Harp Society hymnal, and that was my reflections on that song of parting, that precious thing that I heard in the mountains of North Carolina in my youth. So always drawing on the low church, the high church, raping and running, doing all I can to reflect, to react to these common stolen goods we call Americana that weaves throughout the fabric of my work. So, should we have some questions or try to? What do you want to do?
We're almost there. We're almost there. You want to do some questions now? You're bored of me already.
I would prefer to listen to music. I think it was Zappa who said, talking about music is like dancing about architecture.
Yeah, excellent. One thing I did want to get to before we open it out to questions is really bringing it up to date, because of late you've toured with Fleet Foxes, and one of the more unusual collaborations that we should mention is you collaborated with a young man named Skrillex. Tell us about how that came about and how a man of your musical stature approached a project like that.
Well, you know, like I say, you know, this is once again a lesson in a caution against feeling superior, especially, I think that's especially important if you really do have a great musical ability. I think it invites arrogance, because you know how damn good you are. You've been told all your life. You've amazed people maybe with signs of prodigy in your youth. Somehow you survived as a devoted musician. You wonder if there's ever going to be a real payoff. And I think in the process you tend to overly self-protect, and that leads to feelings of like auteur, maybe like you might be too good for something that's offered. That's a just common part of the human comedy. But in fact, I've spent a life of taking that road that Yogi Berra said would lead to a fork when I had to make a decision. And the decision was based on two things. One is, am I too good to do this? And the other is, am I up to doing this? And I've never been above doing anything. If I'm not doing music, I do music. So when Skrillex called, I was through an intermediary, a record company was a conference call. Some very protective vestigial organ called a record executive. I was on the line, and here all of a sudden was Skrillex, and Skrillex was calling from Belgium, it turned out. I said, where are you calling from, Mr. Skrillex? He said, Skrillex. I said, well, where are you calling from? He said, I'm in Belgium. I said, well, what are you doing there? He says, I just played a concert. I said, oh, really? For how many people? He said, oh, about 350,000 people. I said, really? Did they come to see you? He said, yeah, they came to see me, you know. I said, well, that's very interesting. Well, what do you do? I'm a DJ. I said, well, that's great. I don't know what a DJ is, really, but I'm not proud of that. And I said, well, that's great. I said, what can I do for you? He said, I want you to do an orchestration. I said, okay, just if you send it to me and I feel capable, I'll do it. And he said, oh, great, Mr. Parks, we'll destroy the world. And so I put down the phone. I did great. And I put down the phone, I think, what? We'll destroy the world, so we're going to destroy the world with Skrillex. I go on one of these. I go on my laptop. I YouTube. I get Skrillex. There he is in Belgium in front of 350,000 people. Skrillex steps up to his laptop, and he pours a beer on it. The crowd goes into a state of erection. They're in ecstasy, and I think they're on ecstasy, too. I mean, it's madness. I don't understand it. What am I doing here? But the MP3 came on, and all of a sudden, it's on a flat top. I have nothing else to do but a wife asking me where her new shoes are. Or maybe the rent was late. I forget. But there was no two ways about it. I was going to do this job. It confused me a little when I ran into maybe 20 seconds of no chords. I thought maybe that would create a dilemma because maybe I would make the wrong decision. I was at sea. And I must tell you that the results were, from the orchestra standpoint, and that was quite an orchestra. We had to take out the partitions at Capitol to expand the studio A and B. They were all delighted and as amazed as I was that we survived it and landed on our feet. And why? The reason we did this is because there were 350,000 unemployed European youth who were desperate and hopeless and drugged and unable to find any transformation other than through music. And I decided that it was a political obligation for me to serve that man with all my heart. And that's why I did that Skrillex session. So I go into things with a totally unjudgmental attitude. I am slow to judge and quick to praise. Anybody who makes music has got my vote. It beats bombs in Baghdad. It beats munitions. It takes grit to be a musician. And it takes the ability to serve people faithfully and be slow to judge. And so all I can tell you is the check didn't bounce and it had a comma in it.
The bonus track on Skrillex's Bangarang EP, as arranged by our guest today. Before we open out to questions, you wanted to play something that you brought in, right, from this CD?
Yeah, I think it's good for people to know that that it's also a marvelous opportunity to be involved with film scoring. And I do it on various levels, and for sometimes I do, if there's no money, it might be, you know, with like a synthetic arrangement with dovetailed strings. Maybe I get a violinist on top and a cellist on the bottom to try to fool the discriminating listener into believing that we have real music here. This music is all orchestral. And like I say, 800 copies were printed of the Super Chief. I hope that it will be released, that I can get it released in the United States. But if that shouldn't happen, I want you to hear what my present tense is in movie scoring, because I delight in it. It's a nice thing to know that the music is being used. It's not being argued down by some rock Nazi journalist, you know, who knows as much about a crucifixion as a rabbit does about Easter Sunday. They leave you hanging there, folks. You cannot make your case with critical acclaim or the defamatory remarks they might make about your best effort. Just knowing you did your best often is enough. So I did my best on these. Let's look at two. We played some of one when these innocents came abroad. I take an exception and divide the cellos into five voices on that sharp nine. Here is another, just a taste of this, to let you know I go on with this theme on track three. Same theme. Thank you so much for indulging that.
There's a whole CD of this stuff, so we'll play it after the session and we can leave it playing. But for now, it's question time. Don't be shy. I'm sure there's plenty of things. Wait for the mic. Yes, sir.
Hi. Thanks a lot for your lecture. It was very inspiring, and I felt very identified with many things you said. I would like to compose music. I normally make songs very often, and I don't play them again. And many times people tell me that I should focus on something. I like to make music for, I've done cartoons and short films, but I'm kind of starting. So I would like to know what you think about the importance of focusing on some style, for example. And as you said, I don't know, I feel very comfortable at being nobody and trying to make something maybe for the image or for the concept of other people. And I enjoy that process. So I want to know about that. I also would like to know if you use any technique for making your own script to organize the discourse on your compositions. Because, for example, for me, sometimes I try to do, like, not the score, but, like, I don't know, kind of like tension curves or intentions throughout the song structure. And if you can recommend any book about the experience of composing, or like a continuation of your lecture through a book that I can read.
Are you talking about songwriting or composition in general?
Composition in general.
Oh. You know, at the outset, it's very interesting because it's sad to say, but don't be disappointed. It's sad to say the way cannot be told. The way must be found. Damn it. Okay? That's the truth. Okay?
I believe you, but I'm sure you can have some tips.
But I tell you, I haven't found any instructive manual that prepares me for what for music composition. The thing about the nice thing about having an opportunity to work on a film, if you can find a colleague, a broke filmmaker who has no money to give you to put some music on his film, for example, what doing something with a predestined through line? Suppose he has 20 minutes of music and no money. Okay, I'll do it. You know, and I do things like that. I do a lot of free stuff just to stay engaged in music and to try to learn. But it's very helpful to find those answers just by being there and having the shock therapy of not being prepared at all. What this has led me to is a contentment in one fact. And I know it sounds like a cop-out, but I have found something which I think is an indispensable lesson in music. You must know that you do not know. You must know that. You can't know nothing. When you enter the field, because if you have powers of prediction and so forth, I applaud that. Maybe you're a Presbyterian and know what tomorrow's going to bring. I don't. I don't know where I'm going. You follow your madness. And you wobble through it. And I think when people can recognize, and that's what I think is the emotional content of your work, is in not knowing. That you're always painting yourself into a corner. Sometimes you have to go back to that place where you went to a blind alley, non-evolutionary musical event, and have to get back to where you were, you know, 40 bars ago. But I think that it's safe to say that you are as good as your opportunities, and your opportunities can be improved if you engage and don't know. You find yourself ending up places you never could have anticipated. And I think that that's the best, short, most productive, honest answer.
Thanks.
Okay. And I forgot to say there was something I definitely should add, because this was a highly biographical display. It's a little embarrassing. We should have just said, the older I get, the better I was. Yes.
Yeah.
Question.
Hi.
I think I would just like to say collectively here that we probably all feel the same way that I do right now, which is loving the human being that is you. And thank you so much for existing and being here and speaking today. It's been indescribable. But I would like to for you to elaborate a bit on what you said about criticism within the music industry and your journey dealing with that, because what you said was quite profound, but very short.
Well, you know, a lot of people don't pay any attention to the static and the bat cave, you know, and of course, that's what happens when you work and it receives any public regard. Interesting how one of my favorite quotations is it is attributable to Thomas Jefferson, who said, "If you reveal your depths, men will ford your shallows." You take that risk in music. You are stripped and bleeding. You're nude in front of the vulgar public gaze. If you reveal your depths, they will ford your shallows. That's, I think that, and also Sally Hemings, was probably the reason that Thomas Jefferson was, as they said, loath to unveil his true affections to the vulgar public gaze. But with this, if you have integrity, you do reveal yourself in your work. You reveal yourself wholeheartedly, and better without hesitation. And then you have to, it just comes at the dinner. You have to take, you know, these positive and negative impulses that this static in this bat cave of bloggery to which we now inhabit. Everybody's got an opinion. You know, I used to think a lot of democracy. Then I ran into airport security on my way here. I don't know, I somehow think it would have been better to be a royal before oil. But I find that it's a distraction to consider what people think of your work. But it's inevitable. So let's just face it. Let's look at the good, the bad, and the ugly. And let's be informed by it all. When I did my first record, some reviewer had the cheek to say that I had created the Edsel of pop music. You know, if I had an Edsel today, I'd be a very wealthy man. And at that time, that really got under my skin. It's funny how insults are so indelible. And faint praise is forgettable. But you have to go ahead, you see. If this is what you were talking about, you have to accept criticism. And as a matter of fact, I think you can learn so much from it. And I try to. And I don't seek the company of people who necessarily agree with me. I would rather have the detergent effect of testing my opinions with people who are entirely at odds with me. I don't feel like I'm preaching to a choir here. I invite skepticism, and I think you all should in your work, and let it strengthen you and your resolve. So, okay. So, because courage is contagious, and I want to tell you something, I'm one tough old bird. Hasn't killed me yet.
Wow, thank you.
This is a very, very good thing. I would be lying to tell you this is Red Bull, but I've had some other thoughts about this, the product of this endeavor. My son told me, I said, what is Red Bull? I mean, I knew it was a field of energy. But I said to my son is 30 years old. He's a journalist. I said, he's also in an imploded industry. I said, what is Red Bull? He said, well, Dad, look at it like this. They represent the new patronage of music. I said, really? Well, that's great. He said, in the collapse of the record business, this is a fact. So in a field of forfeit, this is win-win. Because I think the most significant thing that has happened in my witness to music is that we've lost patronage. It's not like the age of Mozart or the Medici's in Florence. We don't have this. Nobody is helping us the way we want help. I mean, you've received some attention and some support here, but it's safe to say that there is no patronage in the arts. This after the presidency of George W. Bush, when somebody asked the man in the Oval Office, he said, "Mr. President, what kind of music do you like?" He said, "Music? I don't like it." He wasn't kidding. And it shows now in the malaise of American funding. They have ripped out the umbilicus between the arts and a corporatized support that is without obligation. They've ripped that umbilicus from what could really be a gestation of some great talent. I'm sure the majority of you feel underfunded and like you have opportunities that you deserve that just aren't appearing, and you haven't had the good fortune that I have had. But I guarantee perseverance will further. And we must find a way out of this dilemma that is this age that of no patronage of the arts. We must find our way clear of this.